All right, this is no time to mince words as we go into a sort of a quantum meltdown here. So what I have said still stands. I have said basically what I've said, to reiterate, is that both the Pope and the President of the United States have gone rogue. And they're aiding and abetting the hostile takeover of this planet by what I call cosmic corporate culture, which is a sort of like a corporate body of different groups of extraterrestrials who have decided they want to take over this planet. And what's happening is they're fomenting turbulence and lawlessness, and so that the planet can seem to be, they want things to get so bad on this planet that the people will be desperate for some authority to step in to set it back in order. And that's when the extraterrestrials will make their entrance into this world and says, hey, we're your space sisters and brothers here, and we know how to, you're in terrible trouble here, and we've listened to your cries and pleas, and we're here to help you. They're the very ones who are responsible for fomenting all this agitation and turbulence in the first place. So this is a level above what the understanding of most people in the world is at, where it's at. They just are blaming these various people, saying, you're bad. But they're just puppets. They're puppets. And the real movers and shakers are at a higher level and still are in the shadows. In the shadows, waiting until the right time to say, hey, we're here to save you. Look, the world's a mess. They've also been fomenting the ecological problems by inventing so much technology and pressuring us to use it. And they are fomenting the very problems that they come in then and say, we're here to fix the problem, so that we are reason and our faith and clarity will be so shattered by the turbulence that we'll just say, well, you know, any port in a storm, right? Any port in a storm. This is the basic modus operandi that's taking place in this world. Any port in a storm. They want to create such a bad storm in this world that we will literally just say, any port in a storm, come on in, you're here, help us out. And they'll say, thank you very much. Don't mind if we do. And then they will institute their law, their rule, their way on this planet. This is what's taking place here. So, to counter that, we are trying to get help from the saviors, the ultimately get help from the grace of God, which expresses as the Holy Spirit, which is the inner advisor, the inner teacher, and the ambassadors of the Holy Spirit, which you can call the saviors, the sages, the bodhisattvas, the various ones who have had healed perception, who have dropped their arrogance, actually. The ones who have been completely freed from spiritual arrogance are the ones capable of giving us right advice and right help. So we're trying to ask them, we're calling upon them, to all those of healed perception, all those who've repented and been healed of spiritual arrogance, please, we're calling upon you to help us out now in this situation in the world, because we are up against it most severely. So we should all be willing to call upon those who the mind of repentance, which means no more arrogance. We call upon them to help us. Everyone should be calling upon them to give us right advice. What do we do? I want to live in a place where I can live a cleaner life. You know, this world is so corrupt now. It is so incredibly corrupt. It's just amazing. The stuff that's coming, that's in, you know, news, entertainment, television, the movies, the radio, the magazines, the whole culture of the world is so saturated with the most vicious kind of arrogance now. Now, there's another question. People say, well, do you call yourself a Christian? There's a question. I say, well, I'll tell you what. Jesus doesn't care what we call ourselves. He'll ask us one question. Have you applied yourself to the path of repentance? Have you applied yourself to the path of repentance? And if you have, he said, then you'll know. Then I know you and you know me. That's all that matters. If you haven't applied yourself to the path of repentance, he'll say, I don't know you and you don't know me, so to speak. This is a little bit of colorful language because, of course, we, in spirit, we know one another. But Jesus doesn't care what we call ourselves. You know, we can't just go up to Jesus and say, have you applied yourself to the path of repentance? And we say, well, no, Jesus, but I'm a Christian. And I say, Jesus, you saved me and stuff. He says, well, that's not what I said. I said, you must apply yourself to the path of repentance. So I don't care what you profess. If you haven't done what I asked you to do, then you haven't succeeded. How can you succeed? So it doesn't matter what you call yourself. There's a ton of people in this world professing to be this or that, whether it be Christians or something else, who have not repented, who have not applied themselves to the path of repentance. So does that mean that they're going to be saved just because they say that they're a Christian? Absolutely not. It doesn't mean anything, one way or the other. The ultimate salvation is the mind of repentance, which is to drop the insane arrogance that we believe we're a body. You see, the truth is we're not a body. We're free. We're still spirit, exactly as God created us to be. There is no contest with God. There is no deal we need to make with God. We cannot make a deal with God. There isn't any winning or losing. You know, this it's sheer arrogance to suggest otherwise. And we have this dream of sheer arrogance that is baffling us and frightening us, and we must set that down, be willing to set it down, and that takes work. We need to work at this, gradually work at it. So Jesus says, have you been working at this the way I told you to do? Like the way a cow chews cud, constantly working on it. Have you been working on it? Like chewing gum. Have you been working on it like chewing gum? Always saying, hey, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And if you have, then Jesus says, hey, you know me for sure, and I know you for sure. Yeah, there's no issues there. You've been able to dissolve your continuity fear. You don't have that dread anymore. So Jesus can relate to us. Those of who have the mind of repentance are able to relate to us because we're able to relate to them without fear, without retreating into fear. They're always willing to relate with us. It's just we keep retreating into fear. That's the problem. So we need advice. We need advice as to, what to do in this situation, because there is this hostile takeover by cosmic corporate culture, which is fomenting division and enmity and lack of clarity and illogic and emotionalism and blaming and guilt is a culture of victimization and violence and all this stuff. This is being done intentionally here on this planet. This is all intentional. This is how we get this storm. And then we'll say, hey, any port in a storm. You know, there may be a port that we said, we'll never, ever go into that port because this is a disaster, for our clarity. Disaster for our clarity. And yet the storm gets so bad in this world, we're going to say, hey, it looks good to us. Let's go there. It's better than this storm, right? This is how it works here. This is how it works. We don't want to go to that port. That's the wrong port to go to. The port of artificial intelligence, the port of this technology, that the cosmic corporate culture, everything that cosmic corporate culture has to offer us really is part of this dream of arrogance, severely arrogant. And so we don't want to go there. But they're very clever and very tricky, and we are vulnerable because of the defenses that we use against God, actually, make us vulnerable, very vulnerable to these deceptions and to falling prey, as it were, to these deceptions and going along with it. Ultimately, it's our decision, but we can feel like, hey, I need to go along with this. It's outside to go along with it. Now they can say, well, you chose to go along. Yes, we did, but certainly under tremendous pressure and duress. So if we had a better option, we might not. We might say, hey, no, I don't really want to go along with that. If we say, I want to live in a place where I can, when I can try to live a cleaner life that is not so, you know, is not so incredibly corrupt. I can go over so much corruption in this world that I'm aware of. People talk to me, they confide in me, or insiders about who work in various situations, and it's just stunning what's taking place, and it just makes your blood boil when you hear the lies that are being told in the world about by these big shots, designed to split, to fracture, to create a lack of kinship, to alienate us from one another, all under the guise of we need to make things better. You know, it's just really upsetting, and you feel like you can't do anything about it. So this is why we call upon, isn't there a better situation that we can go to, those who want to live a cleaner life and thereby more and more focus on repentance and ultimately getting free. Now the path of repentance is difficult because of our defenses that we use. There's several defenses. The deepest defense we use is mental chaos. The second deepest defense we use is what I call the goddess. And the combination of those two, we only turn to this so-called goddess defense because of the mental chaos defense so intimidates us that we feel we have no choice. We can't turn to God. That we have to win this contest with God. And then the goddess is our own advice, projecting our own advice in such a way as it seems to be coming from some autonomous divinity, which we call the goddess, which then is really advising us as to how to win this contest with God and avoid annihilation. And what the Holy Spirit tells us is that there is no contest with God. There is no annihilation. There is no winning and losing. So you might say the goddess is the adversary of the Holy Spirit. And this is what I've directly experienced in my life. Absolutely. The goddess is totally incompetent. In terms of true salvation, the goddess is totally incompetent and leaves us gives us the worst possible advice. The Holy Spirit gives us the best possible advice. And what the Holy Spirit tells us is there is no contest. And the Holy Spirit has shown me clearly what the situation really is. And this is what the non-dualists have told us. They are correct. They are absolutely correct. Like Sri Ramana Maharshi, Sri Nagasada Maharaj, those are a couple examples that in recent history. There are others. What they tell us, the true non-dualists, the ones who really know, what they tell us is correct. There is no contest. There is no contest with God. There is no deal with God. This is sheer arrogance on our part. Now, Christians say that Jesus died to save them from their sins and this and such. Okay, there is one way to look at that, which you can see if they mean it this way, then you can understand what's being said. And the way to interpret the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection that at least would fit in with repentance and non-dual truth is that Jesus said, okay, you think that your arrogance is so severe that it's actually changed reality, changed God. And Jesus says, that's not true. That is not true. So he said, okay, I will allow the body to undergo the most severe arrogance that you are thinking of, which is the death of the body, that spirit can die. Okay. The idea of that you can die is the most extreme arrogance. Ultimately, the idea that we can change reality is the most extreme, but it's all one arrogance, because in order to believe that we can die, we have to change reality. We think we have to change reality. We have the power to change reality. So he says, death for you symbolizes the most extreme arrogance. So I'm going to put myself through that extreme arrogance, okay? And then we're going to see whether God rejects me or not. So Jesus put himself through the body, through death, crucifixion. And then what happened? Resurrected and said, look, you see, God is not angry with me. God did not reject me. Okay. I live. So this was a way of showing us that no matter how arrogant we try to be, it has no effect on God. That God still loves all exactly the same as always, which means giving all freedom to all, everything to all. All freedom, all everything, all experiencing to all, without any preferences whatsoever. Whatsoever. God does not have any preferences. There's no such thing as someone who's special to God. Okay? There's no place, there's no race, there's no peoples, there's no belief system, there's nothing is special to God. This God is perfect love, actually, which is what Jesus told us. So I'm not sure that many people see the crucifixion that way, but it's possible at some level people do see it that way. We'll let, you know, God sort that out. That's fine. So, you know, we're not ultimate arbiters of who is what here. We just have to take care of our own repentance. Each one has to take care of their own repentance. But what I found is the arrogance is so extreme, and the defenses against what we think is losing to God in a contest are so extreme, very powerful, that we have used to frighten us. Say, oh, we can't drop this because we can't drop this arrogance because that means we'll lose. So we have to keep the arrogance going at all costs. So we must scare ourselves away from, or actually, what we scare ourselves away from it with mental chaos, this experience of mental chaos, and then we say, help, 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 and then two helpers show up. One is the Holy Spirit, and the other is the goddess, and those two, we're not sure which one to go for, so we kind of tend to vacillate between the two of them. This is what I've experienced. And you go with the Holy Spirit for a while, and then you feel like, wow, I'm not going fast enough. And then you might go to the goddess and say, hey, goddess, I need help. And the goddess say, of course, I'm here. I'm the co-redeemer with the Holy Spirit, or with Jesus. And I know stuff that the Holy Spirit doesn't know. And the Holy Spirit can, the reason why you're God, it's not working for you is because I'm part of the situation. I have to help out too. It's not just the Holy Spirit. You get this lie, and you want to believe so badly this is true, that you make it seem like it's really very believable, and then you begin taking the advice of the goddess, and that turns out to be disastrous for you. And ultimately, then you can go back and for me, you go back to the Holy Spirit and say, hey, you know, this was a mistake, big mistake. And did the Holy Spirit reject me? No. This is keep working. I'll get you back on track here. And you're never really that off track, but now you realize, hey, you see what's going on in the world. Absolutely, I see it. Redemption is very easy. Repentance is very simple, very clear. There's no exception to reality, the truth. There's no exception whatsoever. Reality is perfect. There's nothing wrong with reality. There's no exception whatsoever. It's sheer arrogance to believe otherwise. So, we turn to the Holy Spirit, we turn to truth, and ask for some advice right now. And I've said the path can be very difficult, and it is difficult because the vacillation, the uncertainty, the continuity fear, you fall victim to the idea you can blend the bad advice and the good advice. 1 minute, please. 1 minute, please. So you fall victim to this notion that there's this co-redeemer that has to work, yeah, the Holy Spirit has to work with the goddess to get the full truth of it. And since what this does is it's a play of your own vacillation, your own elation, trepidation at play. You say, yeah, I want to be saved, but whoa, it's kind of frightening. The continuity fear is frightening me. So, yes, Holy Spirit, then no, wait a minute. No. Hey, goddess, help me out. Help me out. Help me retreat. Help me retreat. Help me retreat. Like that. And of course, the goddess wants to make the retreat seem like it's an advancement. What better way to make a retreat than to make it seem like you're advancing? And so this is why it's such a dangerous situation for us in terms of delay, is when we listen to the advice of the goddess, we go in full retreat, away from the Holy Spirit, away from truth, and we try to, we tailor it in such a way as it seems like, oh, we're going towards what we really want. We're really going towards something, you know, better. It's easier. It's better. We like this. And so we think it's an advancement. We're advancing towards what we want. But it's really a full-scale retreat. This is what I have discovered through bitter, bitter experience. Certainly a lesson one through the most regretful and difficult experiencing. So this is why the Holy Spirit suggests the practice that has been shared here is this full stop in the wow, to preclude you deviating into calling upon the goddess, who will most certainly respond to you and say, hey, you know, yeah, what we often hear, like, in Christianity is the idea, and especially in Roman Catholicism, is that the goddess is an intercessor that intercedes with God on our behalf when Jesus somehow fails, when praying to Jesus isn't good enough. Well, then we pray to the goddess, and she comes in and she intercedes on our behalf. So in other words, what they're really saying is somehow God is what, angry and aggressive and emotional towards us, and the goddess has to calm God down and say, hey, don't be so strict, or Jesus is too strict with us, so the goddess has to come and say, hey, there's a way that you don't have to be so strict, I know how to finesse this, you know. And well, what does that mean? You know, if you start looking at that, you say, well, wait a minute, these are some incredible assumptions that are being made here. Jesus is too strict, really? When he tells us that there's no exception to truth, that's being too strict? Or is that being exactly right, what needs to be said? And the goddess says, well, you know, no, there can be some exceptions. I'm an exception, and, you know, and you love me, and I'm wonderful, don't you think? And you say, yeah, you're wonderful. I say, well, then, you know, don't worry. Jesus is being too strict, and there's a better way to do it, that's an easier way. I'll show you how to do that. And you say, oh, thank you. The other way is so difficult. I get it. So easy to get caught up in this goddess situation, which I certainly did. And getting out of it is very difficult. Because you think that, you know, maybe the Holy Spirit's angry with you. The Holy Spirit's not angry. The Holy Spirit has shared everything with me, the truth. The Holy Spirit only shares truth with us. That's what's its purpose, is to save us by sharing truth. And so it's happy to share truth with us. And when we go, it knows our ambivalence. The Holy Spirit's aware of this. It knows our ambivalence. The first thing the goddess told me, the very first words out of her mouth was, I'm Jesus' partner. I'm working with him together, and the two of us together form a partnership. So whatever I tell you, is Jesus is okay with for sure. That's the first thing out of her mouth. So you can trust me absolutely. In other words, if you're following my advice, you're following Jesus' advice. This is the assurance that she gave me. Well, of course, what would you expect a defense system to do except start to tell the big lie from the very beginning? Because defense systems are there to reassure us that there's a way to stay away from God. You know, a way not to lose to God. Because we think dropping our arrogance is losing. Dropping our arrogance is losing. That's not true. That is completely untrue. Our arrogance has never had any effect on God whatsoever, or neither has it had any effect on us or anything whatsoever. It has no effect on reality. There is no contest taking place with God or with us. There's no contest at all. So how can there be a winner and loser? There isn't any. There can't be any loser. We can't lose. We cannot be annihilated. All of this is our own arrogance. To say that it's arrogant to say that we force God into a contest when that's impossible. It's arrogant to say that God could annihilate us if we should lose, that God is going to annihilate us. Who are we to arrogate to God that God can annihilate us? because we're an extension of God. If God could annihilate us, God, then God would annihilate itself. So that is, you know, totally arrogant to even imagine this or believe it. Sheer arrogance. As again, I say that all of this world and the troubles, the turbulence, and all of this body, cosmos, world, nature, is sheer arrogance on our part. Nothing other than absolute 100% sheer arrogance. Nothing more than that. With no effect whatsoever. So, but we feel that because we want to win, we have to have a loser too. You see, we want to beat God. We want to defeat God, actually. So we say, hey, the loser is annihilated. That's our own imagination. There's no truth to that whatsoever. We cannot enforce an annihilation upon ourselves. It's impossible. But in order to keep that notion that it is possible, we enforce this notion of dying upon forms. And we identify with these forms that disintegrate and believe that this proves that annihilation is possible. So therefore, we believe there is a contest taking place and that the loser is annihilated. Which is, we believe we're going to win and God's going to be annihilated. We'll be the new prime creator. This is the arrogance of spirit, the desire to be greater than God, which is actually just a whim on our part. But it became very heavy and serious, you know, for us. We thought, oh, this is just like, let's just play this game, play this whim, let's have this adventure. And we didn't quite realize, you know, the ramifications in terms of scaring ourselves and intimidating ourselves. So, in order to avoid this goddess defense, which the world has fallen into in an extreme way right now, is all about the goddess defense right now. It's just blatantly obvious. Anything that basically says no to the goddess offense, now the world claims that there's a war, that you're warring on women, you're a misogynist, you're warring on women, you know, you're keep suppressing them, you know, all this, you know, extreme reaction towards anyone who dares speak and say, hey, you know, no, this is the goddess offense that's actually in play right now, and this is based on our super intimidation of the mental chaos defense that we use. Both these defenses can be seen through, as we have here, done here, both of them. We can shine light upon both these defenses, which is something we don't believe is possible. We feel so intimidated, we've intimidated ourselves so badly by this belief that there's such a possible potential of annihilation, of losing a contest with God, or God losing a contest with us, that annihilation is going to happen to one or the other. And we've intimidated ourselves so badly with this that we then are so scared of this that we keep these defenses going, which basically push us towards winning the contest. Now the goddess is all about winning the contest, all about keeping it going and winning, and telling us you can win this contest. You could have whatever you want. You don't have to repent. God says she has these special ways to. But it turns out they're lies, they're deceptions, they're cheating, they're sleazy, they're distortions. They're all this stuff which is so incredibly sleazy that the world is falling into this hideous, sleazy goddess pit. That's what you get, actually. That's what you get. Very corrupt. Severe corruption, you know. Just don't worry, I can put you in a high position. Well, what do? You cheat, you step on other people, you lie to them, you deceive them, you crush them, you dispose of them, you do everything you need, you can think of, dishonest to gain a position of power. And then the goddess will say, see, I put you in a position of power, and yet you feel so dirty, unclean within, you know, that you've compromised yourself to such a terrible extent. And even then, you know, how do you protect yourself? You still have to become more and more vicious. And so the people, you see these people in positions of power, and you see how corrupt they are, what liars they are. Well, they had to do that to get to where they are, because they're following the vice of the goddess. These people who are, you know, high up in the politics and such, and are aspiring to be more and more powerful, they got there because they listened to the goddess. The goddess is the one that puts you in high positions in this world in terms of worldliness. Okay. The Holy Spirit puts you into wisdom, high positions in terms of wisdom, in terms of repentance, okay, in terms of salvation, in terms of repentance, in terms of freeing your mind from fear. The Holy Spirit puts you in better and better positions along that path. So you may very well not end up as some, you know, ruler or elected official or in a high bureaucratic position or a high political, high social position or these various ways. You may not find yourself there, but you may find yourself in a position being very influential and reassuring that these severe defenses that we use, the light of the Holy Spirit, the light of truth, the grace of God can be shown upon these defenses to the point where you say, oh, I see what they're about. Now I get it. Those don't intimidate me anymore. They don't intimidate me anymore. And further question is well, you know, then what do you do? You know, I don't know exactly. Let's talk about the idea of, is it possible that there's other places that to be relocated to as this world goes into this intentionally generated turbulence here? Well, basically, that idea it's not. Christians aren't the only one that have this idea. Like the Buddhists have this idea of the pure land, Amitabha, a Buddha, idea of a, you know, pure land. There's places you can go to, but it usually is after you die. That's idea. And other teachings have ideas of going to, you know, heavenly places, etc. And I believe the Christians may be they're one of the groups that talk about you can actually leave this planet without dying. You don't need to die. Once you're in Christ, accepted Christ, then once you accepted truth and repented, that you can actually leave this planet bodily or be transformed into a body of light and go to another place. That'd be nice. But the kicker is, though, that the Christians say, well, they're the only ones that can go there. And if they don't go there, that means that it's not happening. Or they can even say, well, it's not yet, it's not ready or whatever. Assuming that if anyone can go, they would go. And if they don't go, it means, it's not operative yet. Well, what about the Christians who have not repented? They can claim the same thing. Since we're not going, it must not be happening. And we say, well, wait a minute. What about the ones of any faith who have gone a long ways on the path of repentance and are ready, prepared to go to relocate? You know, who cares what the label is? The only label we should carry is repentance of our arrogance. That's it. And repenting means of your to see through the defenses that we've used to defend our arrogance. That's real repentance. So this is what really counts. In other words, it's factual, it's pragmatic, it's actual, that we need to see through these defenses and recognize the defenses we've been using and then say, no, I don't need those defenses. I can go somewhere where I don't need those defenses at all. Then you have repented. You know, then those defenses don't bind you anymore. You're not listening to the advice of the goddess who's saying, you must stay here, we'll build a utopia here, don't worry. Great divine beings are coming here to organize this planet properly, meaning the extraterrestrials, actually. That, you know, and we're being, you know, led right into the belly of the beast by the incompetent advice of the goddess, who is really just the voice of the marketing tool we're using for our arrogance, to be out of believing we have to win this battle that we started with God. God is not engaged in any battle at all. God is not in a battle with us. Doesn't matter what we say. We claim God's in a battle with us? Not true. Truth doesn't oppose anything. There's nothing for truth to oppose. Truth doesn't have an opposite. Every awareness doesn't have an opposite. Doesn't have something that it's at battle with someplace else that says, hey, over here, we're battling you. There's nothing outside of God to battle with God over territory or isness or anything at all. There's no battle taking place. Nor can there ever be. So repentance is seeing this. Repentance is the hard work of actually recognizing this, seeing it clearly within us, and saying, "Hey, I'm through with it. I don't want that anymore. I don't need that. That's ridiculous." This is what repentance really means. It's not just saying, "Hey, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." We're trying to worship Jesus. That's not what Jesus said. He didn't say, "I didn't come here for you to worship me." He said, "Here, I came to bring the good news, right, of repentance, that you can be free." That God is a God of perfect love. That there is no contest taking place. There is no battle with God. There is no separation from God. There is no misalignment with God. None of that is true. That's sheer arrogance to believe that any of that is possible. You are not a body. You're free. You're still spirit exactly as God created you to be. All right? That's a fact. You don't have to get back in alignment. You never were out of alignment. You don't have to believe that that's possible is sheer arrogance. This is what repentance is about. Jesus came to me in 1978 and said, "Hey, if you want to be saved, you better get to work, and you better work fast. You better work very, diligently and severely and continuously. And pressure, come on, keep working at it. Repentance is requires your utmost attention because these defenses are so intimidating." And so this is what I've tried to do. This is what, so I don't worry about, well, what do I call myself? I just want to call myself, repentant. I've changed my mind. I've given up arrogance. This is what I want to ultimately call myself. Any other labels are ridiculous. If you can't call yourself repentant, then what good are any other labels? And if you do call yourself repentant, you don't need any other labels. It doesn't matter who you listen to in order to repent. Wherever you get the advice, ultimately it's all the grace of God, no matter what. There's not some exclusive teaching. Jesus makes this very clear. There's no exclusive teaching. He says this, for instance, in A Course in Miracles, he says that this is just one of many, many, many curriculums. Thousands. I mean, there's so many possible curriculums, actually. And a universal curriculum, he says, is impossible also. And this is just, so if he says, if this is for you, then go as fast as you possibly can. And be very severely... work on it continuously in a very determined and severe manner. A serious manner. So there's many curriculums. So help can come through in many guises, but so can defenses. And I've the two basic ones I've found. I mean, we have refined these defenses to a tremendous extent. So we seem very vulnerable. At least we see a lot of hope in these defenses. Hope that we can win, right? Can win. Believing that to drop our defenses and to see that everything's perfect is to lose. And by our definition, that means we require our annihilation. So we're holding ourselves to this idea of annihilation, ultimately to annihilate God, so that we can be say we're greater than God, that we're the new prime creator. So we're holding ourselves to this, and yet there's no truth in it whatsoever. There's no contest. So we don't need to hold ourselves to this definition, defining our life, defining our being. We don't need to hold ourselves to this false definition of our being, as if our being is subject to a contest, that the losing of it would result in our annihilation. This is a construct that is built entirely out of arrogance. There's not one iota of truth to it whatsoever. Now, in the world, all these spirits here are caught up in this arrogance. Does that mean there's some that are totally wicked? And no, there's no such thing as any spirit that is what we call totally wicked. There are some who are pursuing arrogance in a very vigorous way. You could say that. And yet we may have done that at some point also in the past. But there's nobody who's entirely against salvation. There's not one spirit is entirely against salvation. There isn't any such one. So in the back of everyone's mind, there is this willingness to listen and be saved. Even though, and superficially, there might be some of those leading the charge of arrogance who might seem to be so unrepentant that you just can't believe they could ever repent. But in fact, they will eventually. Everyone will. So, as I speak about various going rogue, you know, speak about the Pope and the President have gone so rogue, you know, does that mean, oh, that they're terrible? No, it means that they're just actually, you know, are quite unrepentant and will need to work on repentance. Absolutely, very, very much so. Along with everyone else who needs to work on repentance too. There's no way that you can separate yourself from God. Just to believe such is sheer arrogance. Again, sheer arrogance. You cannot ever run afoul of perfect love, actually. It's not possible. God gives all freedom to all experiencing to all perfection to all. And this is how it is, and this is how it shall remain forever. And there's no way to change that, no matter how we pretend to act out in various scenarios, supposed wickedness and separation and all of that. There's no way to change it. And by the same token, fomenting turbulence in this world is, you know, it's not something that we rejoice in at all. It's something that we very strongly condemn. And strongly point out what's going on. Hate the sin, love the sinner. By condemning it, we are not condemning the one who's advocating, because we know that God is perfect love and God doesn't condemn anyone in any way whatsoever. We are saying that we pragmatically, we certainly don't want to be under the pressure and influence of this arrogance. The idea we have to win, under the pressure of the belief we have to win at all. That there's some sort of winning that has to take place. Or some sort of waiting that has to take place. Or some type of appeasing that has to take place. Or some sort of deal that has to take place. We don't want to be pressured into this false belief system at all. We want to be, you know, as far away from that as possible in terms of influence. Someone once said, you hang out with losers, you become a loser. You hang out with winners, you become a winner. Well, if you hang out with the unrepentant, you tend to become very unrepentant. If you hang out with the repentant, you tend to become very repentant. Now, there are many who hang out in, for instance, places of worship, who are trying to repent, but generally they don't realize how difficult it is and how severe the defenses are, and they tend to accept some arrogance as false and some arrogance as true. And this is the major pitfall that we struggle with, and this is what Jesus really is working to help us out with this, you know, that lies and truth can't both be true. And this idea of compromise and saying that, well, some arrogance is true and some isn't, is the fundamental falsity that we must overcome. We must overcome this. And it's not easy, to say the least. And yet, in a situation, you know, where we're fomenting so much turbulence, is being fomented, not only by those who believe that they're here living in this world, but by those from other worlds, other star systems, are very much involved in fomenting this turbulence here. Now, does that mean that everyone and from all star systems are this way? Not necessarily. There might be some from star systems where other dimensions, where they are much more repentant. That is possible. But beyond that are those who have a truly a healed mind, a truly repentant mind, and there's no arrogance at all left None whatsoever. Those are the saviors. Saviors, the sages, the saints, the bodhisattvas, the avatars, the gurus, etc., the masters, the various self-realized ones. So there are different degrees of repentance. I mean, in terms of how far along the path you are, that is for sure. And so, yeah, it's possible that there are those from other star systems that are more repentant. It's also possible there are ones who are less repentant than us, who are even more arrogant than us. That is very possible. And we're pretty arrogant here, that is for sure. See, arrogance doesn't recognize its distortions, its lies. It can't. It's a terrible mental state, arrogance. And it simply doesn't see that it's arrogance. Because it feels the ends justify the means. I mean, the end justifies the means, yeah. And so they refuse to see it as arrogance because they think they're going to win. And that the winner takes all. And so there's no God to say that you're arrogant. They think God will be wiped out, reality will be wiped out. And then there won't be anything that then shows that they're arrogant. Because the arrogance says we can change what reality is. And if we succeed at that, they say, okay, it's not arrogance. So this is why they don't recognize their arrogance for what it is. They don't see it that way. So they continue vigorously on their path that is so full of lies, actually. And those on that path, they value lies above all else. So they tend to follow those who are the most skilled liars, is what actually takes place. And a lot of politicians, especially the ones that reach the highest levels, are often the most skillful liars, the ones who lie in such an artful way that people say, wow, if only I could do that, life would be so much better for me. that's who they vote for. They feel that's the key to happiness. If it could only be artfully deceptive. People don't really want to be crudely deceptive. Although I've seen some that are that way, and you kind of look at them and just shake your head and say, wow. People just say, oh, isn't that awful? Of course, they don't see it. They think that they're deceiving. And they think that they're so smart. But others see it as just clumsily deceptive. But then the ones who are very artfully deceptive, most of us kind of look at it and say, wow. That's very slick, isn't it? Very slick. And so we give them a free pass. We vote for them. We say, hey, we want you to help us be like you. Because we see that as winning. Hitting a low point here. I suddenly just, boom, came upon me very fast. This means that the intensity of the video has been so intense, it's now affecting my breathing and how I feel, because, so a little bit of full stop in the wow. I've said the full stop in the wow is the protection from our defenses, especially the goddess defense. Because when we start vacillating and not recognizing what's going on and keep saying, hey, I need to win, that's when we become vulnerable to the goddess, who says, sure, once you have these two sides and I'm helping out one side and the other help out the other side, and together we can win. That kind of thing. So what we do is when we get this feeling of elation, of succeeding, and trepidation, of I'm succeeding too much. This might end up failing. There's an inner trepidation that it says, I'm not familiar with this much success. I can't succeed entirely. Because If I do, I'll be annihilated. So what we do is we say, when we feel this feeling of elation and trepidation, we say that's the wow feeling. And then we full stop in the wow. It's just no conceptualization. We just stay right where we are, be very patient. And this protects us from the goddess, actually, the goddess defense. We don't turn to the goddess defense. We say, I don't need it. I'm just being patient with this full stop in the wow. And since I've been practicing this consciously, there's been just an enormous advance to the point where I've been able to, again, shed light on the goddess defense and on the mental chaos defense, both. Whereas before, it couldn't do that. The goddess leads you away from this clarity, absolutely, so that you feel still intimidated by it. It's as if we could intimidate ourselves into winning against God. Now we think that being intimidated is the key to success, that we're being driven, that we need to defeat God, and the reason why we're not is we're not driven enough, not motivated enough. So that's why we'll drink the pots of coffee every day and try to help, ask the goddess to help us out in so many ways. We feel this helps us succeed and defeat God in this contest, that we need a champion to help us to defeat God in this contest. And the goddess defense is like this champion, the heroine who can come in and knows how to supposedly defeat God. But what ultimately, she ultimately drives us to suicide. And the goddess thinks that this is actually proof that there's this autonomous force that can't help itself but die. So this is what I've seen. I've seen the goddess intentionally gives us advice that literally moves us towards suicide, moves us towards despair. So terrible. Turbulence and despair so terrible there seems to be no way out of it. And you say, well, the only way out is to just I have to take my own life because I don't see any way out of this. This is actually what the goddess is driving us towards. And then we can claim that there's some autonomous force that brings death upon us, you see, and therefore proves that God is not perfect, and then we win. We win. And of course the goddess disputes this and says, no, it's the Holy Spirit that's leading you to suicide, not me. I'm the one who's helping out. So there's this, you know, it's hard to determine. It seems difficult to determine what is what. Now, does that mean that all women are wrong? No, the goddess is not a woman. The goddess is a defense that uses all the marketing strategies of what we call feminine wiles and even more so to seduce us, to deceive us, to make us feel comfortable with her, to make us think that she's like our mother and we're a child and she's going to raise us properly. That sort of, you know, dynamic or a wonderful lover or companion or something that makes us feel like it's this worthwhile, it's worth it to listen, to take her advice, you know, it's worth it. Whatever the pain and suffering is, the good times she gives us are worth the suffering and pain. This is the goddess defense. There is no goddess, okay? There is no such thing as a goddess. It's just a defense. Now, there have been female bodies associated with a spirit that comes into this world, the den of here to hell, who these spirits have been enlightened, absolutely. But that doesn't have anything to do with the goddess, actually. Running into turbulence of fatigue here. Because saying this stuff is part of the fatigue is also a defense. It's like saying, oh yeah, I could see that reality is perfect, but I'm too tired. I can't sustain it. Oh, I could sustain seeing this, but I'm too tired. I have to sleep. This is a very strong defense that we use. So, I'm sure for people of this world, they realize going along with the agenda of the world, they're saying, uh-oh, you know, this is getting worse and worse. And some people are probably getting more and more angry. Because basically, if they can't breathe, you know, ideologically, they can't breathe. They're being ideologically suffocated, actually. This is what's happening. I mean, ideological suffocation is taking place in this world. And if people go to the goddess defense, then the goddess just advises you, yeah, just succumb. That's okay. Don't worry. Or I might advise you, fight against it. I will inspire you to win. You know, but none of the goddess's advice is helpful, actually, I've found. But we feel if we don't have the goddess defense, what do we get? The mental chaos defense. Most people are not aware of this, only very, very vaguely. But they just feel some vague threat, some terrible threat, if they don't accept the goddess defense. So if you drop the goddess defense, oh, then there's the mental chaos defense, and you have to be able to see through that one. And if you can see through that one, then of course you're not going to be intimidated by it, and therefore you won't feel vulnerable to the goddess defense. So to the extent that we work on the mental chaos defense and recognize that for what it is, then we won't be vulnerable to the goddess defense. We have this sort of, you know, resistance to it, very strong resistance. So the world used to have a much stronger resistance because people were trying to repent, putting more effort into it, which at least generates some momentum, enough to say, you know, I don't think I need this goddess defense. Well, in another way you could put it, it was people were they were using the mental chaos defense in such a way that they're trying to accept it and say, okay, I can live with that. I can live with that. And they say, we don't need the goddess defense because we have this one and we're going to keep this one. But now we're so tired of it, it doesn't work. Now we say, that doesn't work. So it's useless. So what do we do? Oh my gosh, we're terrified. Our mental chaos will grip us. And that's where we very easily fall prey to the goddess defense, very easily. And most in the world have fallen head over heels into this, you know, black pit. And some are resisting, saying, you know, wait a minute. And both those who identify the physical identity of a female, those are male, both of them, with the spirits that are associated with them, these spirits absolutely can get free of this delusion. And they don't need to use this defense. They can practice full stop in the wow instead. So this is why full stop in the wow is so important. This is, I've been able to get this information through the world. It protects from the goddess defense, so you no longer have this ambivalence between the advice of the Holy Spirit and the advice of the goddess. You no longer have that. When that arises, instead of indulging both, you say, okay, I know the Holy Spirit has the right advice, but I understand this continuity fear that I have leads to ambivalence, a mixture of elation and trepidation. So I'm just going to full stop in the wow and not take any advice at all for a while. You see, full stop, I'm not taking any advice at all. So that way I don't run over to the goddess and say, hey, goddess, I'm kind of scared. Can you help me out? The Holy Spirit's helped me, but I need your help too to retreat from this. You say, no, I'm not going to retreat. I'm going to understand that this continuity fear is a temporary thing, and I can trust in the advice of the Holy Spirit. But part of the price we pay for success is this trepidation, this elation, trepidation, this mixture of wowness, and I get, and I'm afraid, and so I don't need to run to the goddess for this. I just to be helped to retreat. I'm not going to retreat, but I'm not going to accept any more advice for right now. And the Holy Spirit says, good. Just full stop in the wow. You need to do that. That's the Holy Spirit's advice. Practice full stop in the wow. And then you won't feel, hey, I need help to retreat. Because once you start retreating, following the goddess's advice in retreat, you will not be seeing it as retreat so much. You'll see it as advancement towards a better way that isn't so scary. A better way, which actually is just retreat as much as possible. But what is that? You just mess yourself in more and more defenses, thinking that's protection, and you become more and more into the belief in winning, which is deeper and deeper and darker delusion about God. And you just think that you'll be able to win and that all your problems will be solved that way. Well, guess what? There isn't any winning against God. There's no contest at all. So you do have a continuity fear. You do have this arrogance problem. And you do have to repent. There's no way around it. There is no winning. So that is not a way to salvation. So the only path to salvation is the path of repentance. There's only one way. That's it. There's not two ways. And there's no exception at all. All of truth is true. All of reality is perfect. All of perfect love is perfect love. All of freedom is given to all. There's no exceptions to reality whatsoever. And so this is what we have to keep hearing. There's no two ways to teach the truth. There's no two ways to teach the truth. There can be many curriculums, but the curriculums, none of those curriculums to be effective can make claim any exception whatsoever for themselves. It's impossible. Jesus never claimed an exception for himself. He said it's impossible. There are no exceptions. Jesus didn't say, well, for me, I can go to God and get an exception because God loves me more than everyone else. This is not true. You see, Jesus never said that. It's not possible. God doesn't love anyone more than anyone else. There's no deals to be made, no exceptions to be made whatsoever. Well, it's not, that sun's still way up in the sky, so it can't be that late. How are we doing on this video? Wow, we've already done an hour. This is some great work here. This is the dynamics of what we've laid bare here. I very much stand behind it, from a reason standpoint, from a guidance standpoint of the Holy Spirit, and from what's that? And from personal experience, Now, saying all this stuff, it carries a great load of wow with it, and trepidation, because you know, wow, it's. Most people are not going to accept this because they're going to say no, that's we need exceptions here, we need defenses here, we need, you know, we need to win, and we need our defenses to deceive us and think that they're helping us win. So to lay these defenses bare, most people are going to say, no, we don't want that. It's too strict. Help us, God. It's too strict. You know, we know you have the way. It can be better than this way. And just give us a bunch of pretty flowers, please. I mean, make our lives smell better, you know. And then, you know, take the tinge of sleaziness off of this world. You know, throw some, let it give us some flowers, please. Oh, my gosh. And because this world is so worse than we can even express. As we madly pursue winning, we just reassure and promise one another everything, whatever it needs, whatever it takes, as long as we can then. And again, the end justifies the means in this path, the goddess's path. So the goddess will invite us to do all sorts of bad stuff. And says, don't worry, don't worry. It'll all work out great. The end justifies the means. You'll see once you win, then you realize it was all worth it and it was all okay, because then now you get to define what is okay and what isn't. So how could you lose then? How could you be wrong? You'll simply define yourself. Whatever you did was right. This is the trap. And we're being taught, this is now the de facto teachings of much of this world, is the goddess teachings. Of course, they're all wrapped up in all sorts of perfumed phrases, spiritual phrases and phraseologies, and to try to make it seem as close as possible to truth. We require that in order to deceive ourselves. We got to think we're following the truth, right? Even though we're in order to retreat, we have to think we're advancing. And retreat could only be one direction. It's away from truth. It's away from repentance. It's away from what we must do. That's the only meaning retreat can possibly have. We're retreating, really retreating from what we must do, trying to avoid it. And advancement is towards what we must do. When we're accepting, repenting, that's it. That's really the only advancement, meaningful advancement there is. So again, it's difficult to tape these videos, but I get tired. Very sleepy. It's hard to continue the enthusiasm. That's a defense. So whatever we've been caught up in the past, it doesn't matter. The Holy Spirit's still the same. God's still the same. Our one way is still the same. We must repent. And the Holy Spirit is all never, ever is alienated. Its affection for us is never alienated in any way. It's impossible. Can't hardly keep eyes open. Wow, very intense. We can never ever alienate the affection of the Holy Spirit, the affection the Holy Spirit has for us. Impossible. Same with God, same with Jesus, etc. We cannot ever alienate ourselves from the affection that they have for us. We cannot alienate that at all. Not in the slightest bit. But we can sure try. The goddess certainly tries to get us to do stuff where we conclude that we must have alienated. This is part of the retreat, is to do stuff. We get advised to experience in such a way that we think we must have alienated the Holy Spirit's affections for us. We must have done so, and therefore we really can't trust it anymore. Which means, since we can't trust anymore, we go a status quo, which then would be the goddess. We just feel like, well, we've got no choice. Might as well go with what we, maybe we've got some momentum. Maybe we've earned some sort of favorability towards us, even though that's not true. So, what do we do? What's the advice? What advice does the Holy Spirit have? What advice does Jesus have? We want to get to that. It requires us to not be frightened or intimidated, or not jump back in our defensiveness, because then we wouldn't understand what Jesus was telling us at all. We'd misinterpret it. So Jesus really has no choice but to be quiet until we're able to accept what his advice without misinterpreting it. Jesus is not going to speak with us if that results in us leaping back into these defenses and then distorting and misinterpreting us, because that will provide all sorts of momentum in the wrong direction. So we might say, well, Jesus is being so quiet, you know, and we're upset. So how come Jesus hasn't given, you know, told us, you know, what can we do? What can we do here? I mean, what's your advice? Please help, help, help. We tend to feel like Jesus isn't answering. What's wrong? You know, because the advice we need to hear, if we put it into the wrong context, is really going to mess us up. So we really need to put it into the right context. Now, coming from Jesus, we feel that it's absolute authority, and we need to accept this. So if we can't put it in the right context, that means we would feel we must put it into this wrong context, and we would do that. Whereas now, for instance, if Jesus spoke to someone who could keep it in the right context, and then this someone shared that out with the world, it wouldn't carry nearly the same weight or authority, and people could say, well, I can either take it or leave it. And so they wouldn't feel compelled to put it into a wrong context. They might just say, ah, okay, you know, whoever it is an idiot. Why do I don't need to listen to them. I'm not going to pay any attention. The idea of Jesus coming on a television set and informing the whole world, you know, okay, this is the truth, etc., is so lacking in basic understanding of what's going on that, you know, don't hold your breath for that. People would feel compelled to then apply the advice according to their defenses and their fear, and this would then empower their defense systems to an extraordinary extent. So, I mean, I'm trying to have mercy on Jesus, because it's just like, wow, you know, Jesus knows the answer, knows the truth, knows how to help us, and yet cannot give that out to us until, you know, unless there's a way to do it that's not going to exacerbate our defensiveness. So he has to just sit on it. I'm trying to help with that, but so far, you know, I'm still sitting on it. It's not good. It's not good for us, not good for anyone. But it has to be that way until we're able to accept it and let it be and be able to practice full stop in the wow, actually, which again is so important. This is so important. If you really want to get the helpful advice, practicing full stop in the wow, I feel, is so important. Now, many meditations actually aim at this. They don't call it, use the same terminology that we're using here. But they basically, some of the more successful paths in history have used this technique as their primary technique, because you need to do that in order to make progress. You need to have this ability to detach from any advice at all and just don't act or react on any of your thoughts that are happening. Don't plan, don't strategize, you know. In other words, don't engage your defenses. Now, the price you pay is temporarily you're not engaging good advice, but you're also not engaging bad advice, so you're not losing ground, you're not retreating. And so the way is to get good advice and advance, and then when the advancement brings this wow feeling and you start feeling like, wow, maybe this is really so significant, I'm feeling a little bit, you know, concerned about losing here and the consequences of that, then you stop, full stop in the wow, and then you don't take any advice. So you're not taking good advice, nor you're taking bad advice, which means you're not retreating, okay, because bad advice is what really is how you retreat. So you hold your ground. So full stop in the wild, basically holding the ground that you've covered. You say, I'm not going to retreat. And then after a while, you begin to calm down, and you realize that wow, I haven't been annihilated. And then you're able to then work on flipping the script, which means more advancement, working on assertions to really press your advantage. And then again, you might feel a little trepidation about annihilation, so full stop in the wow. Don't even listen to any advice. It's very safeguard. Because the goddess defense will say, hey, you don't have to listen to my advice now. Why don't you listen to Jesus' advice now? And in fact, I want you to. And what she tries to do is foment us to listen to more advice than we're capable of handling without full stop on the wow, which just then makes us feel more like, I need to retreat, this is terrible, I got to retreat, which then makes you more vulnerable to listening to the goddess' advice. Finally you say, hey, I need someone who can advise me on how to retreat, and boom, there's the goddess saying, hey, you know what? Guess what? It's your lucky day. I'm here to help you. And you think, oh, thank you, goddess. You're so wonderful. How amazing that you, I'm so stressed out by this, wow, you know, that I want to retreat to help, and you're here to help me. Oh, aren't you wonderful? So again, the goddess will try to push us into too much. Now, this is an interesting situation because I'm being pushed now, but I'm being pushed because I'm able to practice full stop on the wow successfully. Certainly, Jesus does push us because this alarming situation in the world is we need to succeed in repentance. So we are being pushed in that way. But we're being told to practice full stop on the wow is the central part of our practice, which is what we have been doing. So it's the right type of pressure. But I am paying a price for it, there's no question. So I'm putting myself under a lot of stress. And listening to this video is putting yourself under a lot of stress. But the ones who are listening realize, hey, we're really up against it here. This fomentation of turbulence, in order for us to, any port in a storm, default into this bad advice, is so strong now. The advice of the goddess is being followed by so many people now. You know, there's so many, you know, call it whatever you want. There's so many in this world who are following the advice of the goddess and being elevated into positions of seeming advisory and positions of advising us on what to focus on, how to react to stuff, what to think. All this, those are now so controlled by those who are loyal to the goddess and following the goddess's advice, which is really retreat into believing and winning. And then the extraterrestrials, the cosmic corporate culture will arise on this planet and say, guess what, we're here to teach you how to win. And they'll, because what they first do is foment this turbulence, which to us feels like losing. So they'll say, and we'll feel like we're losing so bad that we'll be desperate for winning. And they'll say, come along and say, hey, we know how to win. Look at all these technology. This is because we're such winners. And we'll say, oh gosh. So the goddess is preparing us for these, to accept these ETs as, you know, advisors and the ones we need to follow, the leaders that will lead us to winning. And of course, those who are wise realize this is all a trap. It's all a deception. There is no winning. And conversely, there is no losing. There is no contest. So you see those following the goddess's advice more and more are being put into situations where they're controlling the narrative of sporting events, where the contest of winners and losers is so intense, and positioning themselves as if they so were responsible, had a strong say in how the winners are able to win, and identifying who the winners are, and relating to the winners as if, like, kind of like a mother to a son or something, or a daughter or son saying, who's won some contest, saying, so, you know, hey, I'm so proud of you. You know, like pat on the back, I'm so proud of you. You followed my advice and look what happened to you. This is the meta message in all of this situation in the world now, where these contests are being taken place and publicized, televised, and on the, you know, social media, internet, etc. It's all about now those who are working for the goddess. They are now in positions to, immediately after the contest, interviewing. It's like the mother saying, hey, you know, I'm so proud of you. You're following my advice, and look what's happened to you. You're winning. You see what happens when you follow my advice? And the world looks at this, and this is what they're taking in. They're saying, wow, if I follow the advice of the goddess, I'm going to be a winner too. This is what's taking place. There's part of this massive, and then there's also this extreme turbulence being fomented by politically, sociologically, politically, and bureaucratically, to bring about this turbulence where we feel, wow, we need any port in a storm. We're losing. In fact, our future looks like nothing but a massive, terrible loss. So we need some drastic help. And then here comes the cosmic corporate culture saying, well, we're experts in winning. We've been winning for a long time. We know how to help you out. And reassuring us, don't worry, the goddess has prepared you very well for us. Which is a fact, and we have been prepared very well for cosmic corporate culture to go into that port. Doesn't mean that is a right thing to do. It just means we prepared ourselves for it. Just because we prepare ourselves for something doesn't mean that something is necessarily going to be the right thing for us at all. We can prepare ourselves for delusion. And that doesn't make delusion true. We can prepare ourselves to embrace lies. That doesn't make lies true. So, here we are. And we're just continuing to clarify the situation. But at some point, enough's enough. We're just getting clobbered is what we're getting, is what's happening. By this fomentation of turbulence. And if you're someone who wants to avoid that, to feel like, hey, I need to do something, how can I stop this? You know, and you feel like you can't stop it. It's got too much momentum. Everything seems to be aligned with it. All right, someone talk with me today. I just met someone out of the blue. They were helping me with something. And it was turned towards, they turned out to be someone who had great experience in visiting these various places in the United States, actually. And they knew what the conditions really were there in these places. And they told me, they said, this is what's really going on there. And which is exactly what I suspected. And it's not the story we're being told at all in the media. Not at all. So we're being lied to very severely by the media, by the narrative that's going on in the world. This is someone who had gone to these places many times, experienced them, and told me very honestly, they didn't know who I was or what I'm about or anything. They just happened to be talking, yeah, I advise this and I advise that, because if you go this place, oh, stay away from that place. This place is terrible. You are not safe there at all. You will be assaulted there, literally. I mean, without doing anything wrong, you just go there as a tourist, you will be assaulted. That you will be pressured. The crime is just extreme. Stay away. This is a very dangerous place. And other places are not so bad, and kind of raiding the places and telling you, hey, this coincides with what's really going on in these places and how absolutely crime-ridden they are, so severely crime-ridden, how difficult it is to try and bring any sort of law and order to these places, and the pressure that you would be under to, if you even attempt to do this, you know, is just extreme. these places are being used now to push a narrative which is really fomenting turbulence. Fomenting turbulence is what's going on directly. I mean, the cat's out of the bag right now. Now, this is a good thing. I believe Jesus has returned. I believe Jesus is looking for those who are willing to share his good news he has for us. And he's ready for that. And we're trying to get ready for it. Because the cat is out of the bag in terms of the power structure of this world going full blast for a cosmic corporate culture takeover and their plan of fomenting turbulence here and following the advice of the goddess. Actually, the Pope basically said, I advise all Catholics to follow the advice of the goddess. And he didn't use those exact words, but he might as well have. And then our priest, in saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Instead of starting out with that, Our Father, I didn't say the whole thing, but you know what I'm talking about. Most do, many do. You can Google it if you need to. He said, Hail Mary. I said, Whoa. And he said, Whoa. Everyone in the congregation said, Whoa. Everyone was shocked. This is not a mistake a priest makes, okay? This is, so... Because the Pope literally said, follow the advice of the goddess. Now, this is what we need to do. This is what the Pope said. Not in those direct terms, but he might as well have just said exactly that. Follow the advice of the goddess. And so with the Pope, with the advisor, the most preeminent advisor, religious advisor on the face of the earth, there's like 1.3 billion Catholics. It's by far the largest religious denomination in the world. Actually, and this filtering through to all Christendom, and that filters out through secular humanism. Actually, hearing this too, you know, this produces a massive tidal wave, a tsunami, an ideological tsunami has been unleashed by this Pope. Now, the President of the United States is unleashing a tsunami of social unrest, fomenting social turbulence, okay, throughout the world. So he's helping on that part. Pope is doing the other part. So the turbulence is there, and we're being taught we must turn to the advice of the goddess, which then sets us up. The whole thing is a setup now to accept the extraterrestrials as they have the answer, because their advice will be similar to the advice of the goddess that we're following. We'll say, oh yeah, we can follow that advice. That sounds normal, good to us. Yeah, we that's the right way. We get, you know. So we've been prepared for that. And then, and also this terrible storm, social turbulence that's being stirred up intentionally, will say, help, we need to find a port. So we go into this port, and here's this port, and we say, oh, yeah, we've been ready for that. You see how this two-pronged, you know, devilish approach, diabolical approach is being applied to this planet? It's very diabolical. We're being double-teamed right now. So, anyway, the cat's out of the bag, where both the Pope and the President have shown their cards now. You know, there are people commenting like, wow, now the President has shown what he's really about. And there's no question he has. He has absolutely exposed himself and shown his cards by this whole, you know, federalization of the police forces in this country. I mean, it's absolutely, you can see where it's going. You can see it's for the purpose of fomenting even more unrest and feeling of unsafeness by everyone, feeling very unsafe, feeling that the police are somehow the bad guys and all this kind of stuff. Stripping, you know, basically saying, hey, let the criminals run everything, let the thugs run everything. And of course, that makes everyone feel very unsafe. His cards are on the table now. Pope has put his cards on the table. The President put his cards on the table. Now we know what's going on, actually. But of course, they say, well, it's too late. You know, of course, now it's time for Jesus to put his cards on the table. All right? So it's a great time. Don't think it's a bad time. It's a wonderful time in the world. It's the best time possible. We should, you know, maybe I'm dieting right now so I can start celebrating in a while and just, you know, let's just celebrate. Eat. We're so happy. I feel like celebrating because this is the time when Jesus is going to put his cards on the table too. He's waiting for this time so that we would, those who repent would be able to see, oh wow, okay, this is what's going on. we can evaluate the two. We can see that what the two options are about. We understand the diabolical setup that this planet has now been put under, which we were warned about, which Jesus warned us about this. Jesus told us this would happen. Prepare for this. And now we can say, okay, now here's this is the other option you have. You can have this option. I have this option for you. And we can so say, okay, let's A, B, let's compare these two options. And so in order to choose wisely, to make a meaningful choice, you need to see clearly what the options are. And up until this point, we were saying, well, you know, I'm sure, you know, maybe we can keep going down this road of arrogance. But now we see, uh-oh, this is what the road of arrogance has for us now. We've been diabolically double-teamed. And there's this third party now waiting to swoop in and claim this world for their own and really put the shackles on us. Ideological shackles on us. The shackles of arrogance upon us. Shackles of spiritual pride upon us. That's what's really at stake. So, but Jesus, they says, do you really want to put the shackles of arrogance on you worse than ever? Or do you want to decide to really work and complete the path of repentance by removing those shackles? Okay, which one do you want? So I do have faith in this. Now, will that come to pass in this way or not? I don't know. You know, I always keep my mind open that I could be mistaken. You know, it's because I have not yet completely removed arrogance. So always possible I could be blinded. Arrogance makes us blind. There's no question about it. But the Holy Spirit says, look at this, look at this, look at this. And I'm saying, wow. I don't look at much news, but the Holy Spirit sometimes tells me, just, hey, catch this. And I just for some reason, I looked in the paper, and then there was quoting the Pope of what the Pope said. The Holy Spirit said, just look at this. And I saw it, and I just, like the roof came off. I said, holy cow. The Pope is explicitly telling us that the way to salvation is to follow the advice of the goddess, plain and simple. I said, wow. It was surprising. It was shocking and surprising, and you know that it would happen so fast. But I knew that this Pope was, you know, the final Pope really, and is bad news, and everything this Pope's been saying has been pointing in this direction. But you know, to just so blatantly say go for it and just cat's out of the bag, you know, completely risking everything, you know, wow. Of course, I haven't heard a word from anybody about this, which is quite extraordinary. I think maybe people are just stunned and shocked by it. But for me, I mean, I didn't go into shock. I was just wow. And the same thing with what the president's been saying recently of the United States. Wow. You talk about arrogant. You talk about audaciously arrogant. Just, it's a shocker. I think a lot of people are shocked. And they say, I can't handle this arrogance. You know, the amount of repentance they have is not enough to handle this arrogance. So, fortunately, in my case, I have done enough, especially looking at this defense of mental chaos, which is all important, but able to see through it. So I'm not trapped by this arrogance. See right through it and could speak directly to it. But this is not the case for most. And so I think that they're in some, I'm not sure what their state of mind is. I think they're in shock, actually, of what's going on. I think that this may surprise, you know, may surprise has put the world in shock. Isn't May Day the day of international communism or something like that, which is a way of preparing the world for the cosmic corporate culture takeover, actually. So they really sprang a May surprise on us here at the beginning of May. I think the Pope's comments were around May 1st, and same with this president's. His comments are right here in this the early May period. You know, this whole thing has suddenly been sprung upon us. And it is a shocker, to say the least, how how arrogant they are and confident they are, you know, that they're just going, you know, all in, all chips on the table. Well, guess what? Jesus has some chips too. And we'll see how he goes all in. That's yet to be determined. I think he has to wait until we're out of this shock period, you know. He can't do this when we're this shocked. And I've been, you know, trying to work through the shock, and I feel that a lot of the viewers are in this shock, actually. This is what I feel. They're saying, uh-oh, I wasn't sure if I was going to get this bad or not, and uh-oh, it's all in. It's on, you know. Wow. I mean, ideologically, they're dropping the nukes. Ideological nukes are being nuked. They're gone nuclear on us, ideologically. There's no question about it. You know, it's time to get into a fallout shelter, you know, so to speak. But we'll see what comes of this. Two different people have directed me to the same place. That is very interesting. People that don't know each other whatsoever, yesterday and today, in the course of conversation, they both talked about going to the same place in the world. How is that possible? That is really amazing. But that doesn't mean that's the right advice. It could be, you know, goddess advice too. I'm not sure. We'll see. Which is coastal Southern California, actually, for some reason. I don't know if that's accurate advice or not. I realized that. Wow. Actually, interesting. It could just be a symbol, because the place that they actually told me to look for, it turns out, I looked at a map last night. Someone said, "Oh, there's some place right down there, just below this city, and you know, this is a really great place, man. That place is just unbelievable. It's an enclave. It's a safe enclave. It's really wonderful." And Seal Beach or something. It turns out the lagoons are at Seal Beach. Well, what does Seal Beach say? C-L. What is L? L is the ancient term for God, actually. So, S-E-C-L, to see God. Seeing God is the right refuge at this time. This is probably what they were pointing out. To see God. Cannot be a coincidence that two random people that you meet and happen to have a conversation with you didn't expect, happen to, in the course of conversation, talk about how wonderful and safe a place is, and they happen to be talking about pointing to the exact same place. But, you know, how's that possible? But neither one of them identifying it by name. And then I felt compelled. I said, I have to go look this up. It's very important. And what they were pointing towards, it's an identification through saying that these lagoons and this area right below Long Beach or the lagoons, etc., right there. It happens, the name of it is like Seal Beach, and that would be C-L. L is the ancient name we have in this world. It oftentimes is used as L. L as meaning God. to see God is the safe place we need to get to. So it's a state of mind we need to get to. It's a mind. It's the mind needs to see God. We need to see God. The seeing of God is what saves us from this extreme, turbulent situation. This one this person was telling me, just as you go to these cities, you can't walk on the street. You'll be accosted for sure. It's super dangerous. You can't even go there. He's basically, what was he talking about? Just having to stay in the hotel. What is that? Martial law? What is that? That is crime-ridden society. So what he was telling me is this warning me about, I guess, a situation where this world is going to be very unsafe, and saying and then suggesting, you know, a really wonderful place to go. That is safe and really great place. See God. So a place where we focus on seeing God would be, you know, a similar way of relating to this. Not everybody can snap their fingers and see God because of the continuity fear, but certainly we can work on it. There's no doubt we can work. I've proven this. This is what I've proven. We can work on seeing God. We can work and get closer and closer and melt our fear away. We absolutely can do it. I've proven it. I've done it. And the circumstances, the kind of place where you can do that is a place where certainly you feel safe. I was talking to this man about, we'll call it a person, we'll just say a person, that about this area that I live in is you know, maybe the best place in the world, and I feel very safe here. I feel very safe. We've always felt entirely safe, really, and how rare that is, and how helpful that is. Actually, you cannot, if you feel very much subjected to turbulence, it's very difficult to do the kind of focus that we need to do. So I've been blessed by living my entire life in a very blessed place in terms of feeling safe. But even that is now disappearing, believe it or not. And that's why I told him where I live, and he said, you know what, that's a great place, but I think there's an even better place. And he's talking about pointing to this CL place, see God place. Interesting. Because even here, we're starting to have home invasions now. In fact, a whole rash of them happened just several blocks away. The criminals are getting way more empowered. This is what's happening in this country, is the empowerment of criminals. It is shocking to us. We said, never before have we had this happen here. The criminals simply did not feel empowered to do this, ideologically empowered to do this. And now they're simply brazenly invading homes when they see that the occupants have left, just breaking in and stealing everything they can quickly of value. And actually, this used to be happening all the time, just several miles away, but here it hasn't happened. And this is what these people are telling me. They say this crime, you can just one street, this one man used to live in these areas, said one street will be absolutely, you don't dare walk down that street, take your life in your hands, you probably won't survive. It's ruled by drug gangs. And it's just another street over is these, it'll feel like this enclave, which is feels totally safe. And the two never clashed. The drug gangs never went into there, you know. It's just, you could not do that. It just didn't happen. Well, now those barriers are being broken down. This has been done purposefully to empower these drug gangs, to empower these criminal gangs, to go into these enclaves of safety and begin terrorizing them, really. This is what's being empowered in this country. So the turbulence is felt by everybody, you know, everybody. So even those who feel safe and feel, we don't need extraterrestrials here. You know, we don't need that. We're going to continue on our path of repentance. Oh, we're in danger too. Yeah, we need help too. Yeah, we need to, you know, to make pull everybody down into this pit. So this person told me, hey, it's even better. This other place is even safer, even better. So maybe that was preparing me for this, for the being told that, you know, there's a better, safer place, and probably it's a good idea if you go there, because even in this, you know, living here for, you know, 58 years, we always felt so safe. I never even thought of locking our house, locking our windows, locking a car. I mean, a lot of people didn't even left their keys in the car and leave your wallet sitting in the car. You just didn't think about criminal activity here. It just didn't happen. It just didn't happen. And you never heard about it happening. Basically, our ideology says, hey, don't bother us. You know, criminals, don't bother us. Stay away. We don't want you here. But now we're being made feel guilty, you know, for doing that. Guilt is being used on everyone here. Like you're discriminating against the criminals if you're saying don't come here. You know, you're somehow means you're racist and discriminatory. And all this guilt is being used for people to say, oh yes, well, I feel wrong. I should invite the criminals into my neighborhood. And feel coming from a safe family, safe place, that gives us an unfair advantage. We need to ghettoize our community so that we don't have such an advantage over the people who live in ghettos. You know, that's so we need to even things out. It's not fair. You know, all this guilt is being used now in this world. This is literally what's happening here. This is this diabolical scheme to make us feel any port in a storm, to get us onto that level of any port in a storm. Now, maybe Jesus has a port for us that we can, those who are, you know, who are wise can say, hey, that's the right port, because we can continue our path of repentance here, which is necessary. We have to see through these defenses of the goddess and the mental chaos. Those two defenses, all defenses have to be seen through, but those two are the real, real tough ones. We have to see through those. And abidance in non-dual truth is absolutely possible. I have already done this on a couple occasions, been able to get there, and I just couldn't stay there because of the continuing, you know, fear of the backlash and some still residual trepidation and continuity issues and such. But we definitely can get there. We absolutely can get there. In fact, we're already there. We just have to accept that fact. In fact, we have to accept we never left. And there is no path there. There's no path to fail on at all. Believing that there's a path is believing in failure. So the path is the path of no path, and coming to accept that there is no path. That's the only path there really is. But this, it's a matter of disciplining and full stop in the wow and this practice. It's practicing rather than some path that you can fail or succeed on. It's this exchanging belief system thing that you have to work at it. So it's easy to get confused about verbiage. Because ultimately, the awakening is realization is there was never any path. But in order to get to that realization, it will seem as though we're taking a path of accepting that, you know, getting to that. Pragmatically, it will seem that way. But even that path isn't any path deviating from where we already are. It doesn't deviate from that at all. As a matter of fact, it's a path of affirming that there is no path. So that term path has two different levels of meaning here. It's the path of affirming that there is no path. But if we don't affirm that, then we'll get suckered onto a path. We'll keep going on this path, so to speak. So it's very important to take the path of asserting there is no path. Very important. So we're taking off the gloves now, and it's necessary. Maybe Jesus is waiting to see, hey, who's able to take off the gloves now? Who's able to take off the gloves? Who's repented to the point where they can take off the gloves? I don't know. I'm not claiming that for myself. I don't know. Still arrogance can blind us, you know. So it's I'm still not abiding in non-dual at this point, not abiding in non-dual realization. So there's some residual arrogance. I don't know how much. Maybe it's a lot. Maybe it's a little. So there's still blindness is still possible, sure. So I'm just doing the best I can to try and lay it out as I see it here. Knowing that, you know, to do this certainly is like, you know, you have to not retreat from this. You know, this is very retreatable thing, right? I mean, it's like, oh my gosh, what am I saying? I've got to retreat, and then that can jump right into the arms of the goddess or mental chaos defense, actually, which and or suicidal defense, actually, you know, those defenses. In fact, the first thing the goddess tells you is the defense against this total mental chaos is suicide. And if you don't do that, then winning, you know, that kind of thing. So these various defenses, you know, you can easily retreat back into them from saying what I've been saying. You know, this is the stress. So we have two independent people, both pointing us to the exact same place on this globe, in different conversations, in different contexts, and to the best of my ability, identifying this place as Seal Beach, and Seal Beach it has the B-E in beach, C-L in B, C-L-B, to be, being, by seeing God. And you can say beach is B-A-C-H, and C-H could be abbreviation for Christ, be a Christ. C-L and be a Christ. Seal Beach, C-L, B-A, Christ. C-L, be a Christ. See God and be a Christ. this is quite, the Holy Spirit is quite humorous, and it's humorous because it's so amazing. Arranging for these meetings and conversations that I would not ordinarily have, and pointing out the exact same place, and then being an anachronism for "See God, be a Christ," you know, as the answer, and setting this all up, this is, you know, you have to chuckle at the Holy Spirit. I mean, it has ways beyond our imagination. And it's so resourceful. It's so creative. You know, I laugh because it's delightful. It knows every detail of everything. I mean, it's aware of everything. And it's just, it can be so delightful in its creativity. You just shake your head. What can you do except chuckle? C-L-B-A Christ. C-L, see God and be a Christ. C-L, see God, be a Christ. See God, be a Christ. Now, we're told the Christian teachings tell us that in the end times there'll be many false messiahs, etc. Now that this could be very true. It could also be many true messiahs. There could be many seeing God and being a Christ. So it's a very, you know, interesting statement that in the end times there'll be many deceivers who call themselves Christ and wonder workers working miracles here and there. Well, this is a very tricky thing, because this could be an accurate statement to look out for, but it doesn't preclude that there may be many seeing God and being a Christ, many saints in the world too, right? that, and maybe there'd be many, many saints in the world at that time. But it could easily be twisted into saying that all the saints that arise at this time, that they must be deceivers too, because they say, yes, I too am a Christ now. And so it gives Christians who have a narrow interpretation of this all this ammunition, defensiveness to say, oh no, you know, everyone who says that they are a Christ must be a deceiver. You know, that is not necessarily true. If you see God and be a Christ, see God, be a Christ, then you certainly are witnessing properly. Now, we're not saying I am Jesus or I am the only Christ or whatever. See God and I am a Christ. I am a Christ. We could say that see God means I am be a Christ. Means you are like Jesus in that you've dropped your arrogance. You've repented is what it really means. You share the one spirit with Jesus. You're simpatico, you know, you have accepted the same mind, that the mind of Jesus is the one mind of God, and you've accepted that is the true mind without any, there's no flaws or imperfections, there's no contest taking place, so you're seeing God. So those who see God are saved, and those who are saved are like, you can say they are a Christ, they're anointed with the peace of salvation. The still mind, the peaceful mind, the loving mind. So Jesus said, you know, we all have to be like him, like Jesus. We have to be that way. So in the end times, you would expect that hopefully there will be many like that. And the goddess defense will certainly have some, perhaps, claiming to be Jesus themselves to try and mislead us. Absolutely, that is a possibility. Not that the goddess defense needs to use that. It seems like they're being so successful already that it hardly needs to be used. The indoctrination of this world has been so successful, and most people are following. I mean, when the Pope says, "Hey, everybody, this now we all follow the goddess's advice," but we're basically saying what the Pope basically says is it is actually the goddess's advice has been the right advice all along. We were mistaken. We were mistaken to follow Jesus' advice. It's actually the goddess's advice was the right advice all along, and I'm telling everybody now that's what you need to follow, and then you'll be, you know, that'll be the right thing to do. I mean, who needs anyone to pop up and say I'm Jesus when the Pope is saying exactly what the goddess defense wants, you know, to be said. It sort of takes, not really necessary, but there may be some who do that. There have been some actually have already done that. And so we keep a sense of humor about it. Following the Holy Spirit, you can't help but have some humor about it, because we know somehow the Holy Spirit, you know, is just going to do its thing, and it's just so extraordinary how the Holy Spirit works. You never know what it's going to do next. It's just, you can't really figure the Holy Spirit out. You cannot. You don't know how today will be used tomorrow by the Holy Spirit. You might be talking with somebody, but something will catch your attention, and then later on, suddenly the Holy Spirit will put it in context, and you just say, wow, you set that one up ahead of time perfectly. That is really extraordinary. So we do have a good humor, and it brings a smile to our face. Yeah, it really does. You know, just to say, wow, God is looking out after us, but in such a way that it's just, we just can't grasp it, really. Using ordinary situations to extraordinary ends is the Holy Spirit's forte. It's just the freedom that the Holy Spirit has is extraordinary. It's not lack of bias. You know, it'll use anything. It'll use any situation. Any, you know, it can use everything. It's not biased at all. And you can say, "Well, that's funny. I would never would have, you know, used that. I would have said, no, I can't use that. Holy Spirit's not biased." So we're just full stopping on the wow here, which is what we do. I remember I pointed this out. This is the crucial practice that the Holy Spirit told me to use, along with I'm already enlightened. I already know that I'm already free. I already know that I'm already saved. There's no question about it. I already know I'm already saved. This is a very powerful practice too. And then full stop on the wow. Those two protect us from the, you know, terrible defenses of total mental chaos and the goddess defense. Very important. Protect us from retreating and turning to those defenses. The total mental chaos defense is you can start retreating and suddenly you'll feel like trying to figure everything out. I need to figure everything out and start feeling like, oh, it's too much. I'm going to go crazy if I keep thinking about all this stuff. I can't do that. I've got to get away from this. This is too much. I can't, you know, and then the fear of total mental chaos, you know, you start retreating. Again, a full stop of, well, you're not trying to figure anything out. You're not taking any advice. You're not trying to figure anything out. You're just hanging out, just relaxed, loosely, hanging out. No particular place to go, no particular thing to do, which is why we sit quietly like this. It's very important for the practice. You cannot feel that you need to do something. You say, I don't have anything in mind as far as doing anything or not doing anything. I'm just sitting here neutral. I'm in neutral. This prevents you from retreating by being hooked by these defenses that we have. Very vicious defenses. Very tricky defenses. Very subtle defenses. You become aware of those when you practice, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. You become aware of how tricky these defenses are in hooking you, how very adept and tricky they are. As I said before, they'll say, yeah, you're getting great advice, follow more of it, you need to follow more of it, meaning trying to overload you and push through the wow, you see, overload and push through the wow. And then you really retreat, and then they can easily hook you. Whereas here, we acknowledge the wow at all times. Anytime you feel the wow, just stop. You don't have to listen to what's being said. You just stop. Just full stop in the wow. And just talk about the weather. Nice weather today, 80 degrees. Perfect, beautiful California day. It's just 80 degrees and 80 plus and cooling off in the evening time. See God be a Christ. See God be a Christ. Yes, I already know. I've already seen God. I'm already a Christ. Yes, I already know. I've already seen God and I'm already a Christ. So this already practice is very potent. It can bring very powerful wow reactions upon you. So when you practice this, stop. When the wow gets too bad, just stop. Don't prove anything like what your progress has been. Don't say, well, okay, now how much have I progressed? No, just in neutral. Have faith in the Holy Spirit. Have faith in your progress. I don't need to think about anything. I'm just neutral now. I don't know what the advice was I just got. It doesn't matter. I know it was profound. I know I'll keep getting better advice, but I'm practicing the practice that I was given. Full stop in the wow. Practice full stop in the wow. Super successful practice. When we begin to get leverage over these dastardly defenses that we have fashioned for ourselves to deceive ourselves and keep ourselves pursuing the goals of our arrogance. And remember, Jesus saves today. Jesus saves today. Jesus has not disappeared. I've had several dreams where I feel that I've been contacted by Jesus and relating to Jesus. Several dreams recently. One of them, the most recent, was basically the context was he's saying, I'm back. I'm back. I'm here now. I'm back and I'm here now. And I'm ready to relate to you now. I'm ready to relate to the people, those of on this planet. This is what he said. He said, I'm here now and I'm in the relating mode now. So anyone interested in this? And I raised my hand and said, yeah, absolutely. I'll have a go at it. I'll have a go at it. Jesus said, great, okay. All ears, yeah, I'm ready to relate. And so we had some conversation, and I felt he was completely engaged in it. Absolutely full attention. I felt Jesus' full attention was on it. Attention was not wandering off saying, well, no, his full attention was engaged. He's ready to relate now. Having left this planet for quite some time, for reasons which he was very well aware of, proper reasons. Now, he said he'd come back, now he's back. And now he's saying, okay, I'm here, my full attention is here. Now, who's ready to relate? Who's willing to relate? So I was shaken, I was quite nervous about it, you know, saying, okay. But I felt, yeah, I hope I'm ready, I feel like I'm ready. And he says, well, okay, let's relate. And it went fine. You know, just an icebreaker, you know, just breaking the ice. There's nothing I can remember about what it was. Just kind of, you know, what I wasn't saying anything too profound or anything. But it was just the act of relating that was important. I understood that. I wanted to see, you know, what was his attention like? Where was the tension? What's the intensity? Full attention. You know, somewhat intense, full attention, not forcing, not pressing too much, but letting you know that he's here and you know, ready to relate, ready, willing, and able to relate, and wanting to actually. I don't know exactly what he's going to relate, but you know, how can we find that out unless we start relating? How can we find that out unless we start relating? So, maybe we'll talk about the weather first. I don't know what I can't remember what I spoke about exactly, what we were talking about, but it wasn't that, you know, heavy of a thing. It wasn't that heavy. But it was an open question. He addressed the whole world in this dream, saying, okay, you know, I'm back, I'm here, I'm ready to relate, I want to relate. Now who wants to relate? It was just an open question to everybody. It wasn't directed at me or anyone in particular. It was just an open invitation. So, you know, like a classroom teacher, anyone want to answer, ask a question? I said, okay, yeah, put my hand up, okay, I'll do it. I was looking around, saying, has anybody else got their hand up? You know, I don't know. Come on, raise your hand. Let's start relating. Let's start relating and see what Jesus has to say. I don't know what Jesus is going to say. Let's start relating. Very timely, though, I must say. Very timely entrance. Right before this heavy, heavy, cat's out of the bag situation with what we've talked about in this video with the Pope and the President, the two most powerful people in the world, powerful and influential people in the world, nothing else is even close, actually, that Jesus came prior to this, letting us know he's back, he's here and ready to relate. So I already had that momentum, you know, so that helped a lot. I said, I'm not that worried, I'm not worried. I know that we're going to get help. We're not going to be flushed. I said, okay, bring it on. But But you know, those who are not ready, they're screaming. They know that you know, they're about ready to get flushed, and they're just screaming and yelling and just. But I don't get into that. You know, we have Jesus. You know, why should we panic? And by Jesus, I mean the entirety of all of those who have ever been saved, you know, who've ever repented. This is Jesus stands for that. You know, doesn't come alone. Doesn't come alone. That's for sure. There are many who have been saved, and certainly they are all part of, you know, encouraging us to be saved also. From our arrogance and the ridiculous conclusions that our arrogance has pushed upon us as believing they must be factual, when in truth they are not. Again, no contest with God, no deal with God, no business with God, no arrangements with God. There's no winning, there's no losing. You know, everything is exactly, reality is completely perfect. There's no exceptions to it. Everything, we never left reality. Everything is exactly as it's always been. Everything's perfect. There's no abyss. There's no winning, losing. No annihilation. None of this is so God, same as always. Perfect love for all, perfect freedom for all. No favorites, no biases. How are we doing here? We're doing pretty good. This video, I could extend it by throwing up a graphic, but I won't do that. We've done enough here. I'm feeling better, getting a second wind. This is not the kind of garden variety talk that you normally hear here. And this is not the ranting and the raving of the talk show people and the media people and, you know, and reacting. This is not the same kind of reaction that you're used to expecting. This is a very measured reaction. This is a very confident position. This is very calm. And we, you know, we're waiting and preparing for, you know, what cards does Jesus have to play? We've seen the cards from the two big movers and shakers in the world. Now, what's Jesus' cards? What are those cards like? Let's see those cards. You know, we see the hand that's being played in the world from worldly people, from arrogance. We see the hand that arrogance is playing, and we were saying like, oh, you know, wow, you know, I see that. Oh my gosh, you know, strong hand. Well, you know, I say okay, it's a very strong hand, but we know that Jesus has a stronger hand. So we're waiting for those cards to be played with confidence. We're not panicking. We're not, you know, retreating, saying, oh my gosh, we can't possibly beat that hand. You know, four aces, and four kings, four aces, or whatever. Now we know that whatever hand they play, Jesus has a better hand. So we're laughing. We're happy. We're laughing. Really, we laugh at the world. We laugh at the hand that arrogance presents. Chuckle at it. You think that's a great hand? Just wait until Jesus places his hand. That's a great hand. So we're not all freaked out. We're not all panicked. We're not all angry. We're not all desperate. We're not all fear-based, which is what's the term. I'll tell you what, those talk show hosts and media people, they're fomenting a massive amount of turbulence themselves. Which is why I always steered people away from them. Not that they haven't been pointing out some of the problems, which they have, but the reactions, they're part of the problem by stirring up more and more turbulence. Jesus doesn't stir up turbulence. Doesn't stir up anything. It leads us to poise, to calm, assurance, poised. We're not worried. We're not concerned. We have the winning. Jesus has the winning hand. We know that. We just don't know exactly when it's going to be played. But it's the winning hand. So we're not ranting and raving and screaming and tearing our hair and cursing and all this stuff. We're certainly pointing out the problems, you know, but we're doing it in a smile, in a peaceful manner, in a humorous manner, and in a very spiritually poised. We're pointing out the option, the right option to take, and all of this. So this is the better path, isn't it? This is what the path of repentance enables us to have. So for us, it's the best of times, absolutely best of times, because this is cards on the table time, and we'll find out what our options are and be able to more clearly choose the right option for us, the best option. So this is the best of times for those who have prepared. Now they're prepared to see the right option for what it is, because they compare, say, hey, wait a minute, now I see the difference. Oh, of course I want that one. You know, of course I want that one. Absolutely, I want to see God. See God be a Christ. 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 Absolutely. This is the right advice. See God be a Christ. See God be a Christ. Yes, I know. I already know that I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. You can act as if you've already done it. Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. Yes, I already know I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. I'm already seeing God and I'm already a Christ. Yes, I already know. I'm already seeing God, and I'm already a Christ. Already a Christ. Yes, I already know. I'm already seeing God, and I'm already a Christ. It's already happened. It's already happened. I'm already in this. I'm already in this. I'm already seeing God, and I'm already seeing Christ. I already am a Christ. I'm already seeing God, already being a Christ. I'm already seeing God, I'm already being a Christ. Yes, I already know. I'm already seeing God, I'm already being a Christ. Right here, right now, right here, right now. Sheep and the goats. Difference between goat, the arrogance, and sheep, repentance. Repent from the arrogance. Set it down. Parting of the ways between the sheep and the goats. The wheat and the tares. Tares being a general name for weeds, really. They also say the wheat and the chaff. The wheat and the tares. Tares are like weeds. Not wheat. What is not wheat? Yes, I already know that I'm already seeing God and I'm already being a Christ. I'm already seeing God. I'm already being a Christ. I'm already seeing God. I'm already being a Christ. Now, don't fight against other people. I have a situation or comes up where, you know, maybe some other people want to go on the road of arrogance and they're asking you for help and stuff. And so, you know, don't scream and don't yell. Don't have a fit. And then just be kind. Be compassionate. Be kind. When in Rome, do as Rome do. You know, that's what they asked Jesus. And they said, when in Rome, do as Rome do. Don't try and be a rebel. And this is a culture and society you live, actually. It's not required. Just keep your path going. Just keep your assurance going here. Keep your spirit. As long as you keep your spiritual practice going, full stop on the wow, protect yourself from these terrible defenses that we have fashion, then you're going to be saved, all right? So just keep that confidence going. Don't try to change the world and fight against those who don't want to be saved right now. Their time will come some other cycle. So in general, we're winding down the video, cooling out, cool down time from a very intense, shockingly intense, saying things that people just aren't used to hearing being said, putting it into a context that they're not used to this context, showing us how we can, you know, why we should remain very confident and poised. Not at all down, not at all defeated, not at all depressed. Not at all bothered. And continuing on with the...
Yes. Yeah, I'll be in about 10 minutes.
Okay. See, I got to, you know, win in Rome, do as Romans do. There's an airplane coming in, the noise is coming in, so it's showing like it's time to, you know, put this one in the, put this one, upload it, put it online, put it out there for the world. So hopefully we can start coming out of shock, okay? You know, with cards on the table, we realize, okay, that was shock to us, but now we say, great. This is wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. This is all the way it's meant to be. This is how it's been orchestrated. This is the theater of it. So we're not going to turn into screaming monkeys throwing stuff, you know. No, we're saying, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Blessings to everyone. So all will be saved. All is one. All is perfect. Arrogance has no effects. It's non-causative. So nothing, no one's ever left reality. Everything's perfect still. All are totally included. There's only one spiritual family, and we're all it. And so, well, there's no, what are the worries? No worries, really. And we're just, Jesus has the winning hand. Jesus is here. He has returned already, and he's going to play his hand. So why should we worry? Why me worry? Rejoice. Instead of worrying, we rejoice at this time. Actually, we're starting to rejoice. Rejoice, 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 rejoice. Okay, now, be in a mood of rejoicing. Jesus is back. This is the time. The cards are on the table. He's going to play his cards. Okay, and it's going to be all good for those who have prepared. It's got the winning hand. Got the winning hand. Got the winning hand. We'll find out soon enough what that hand is. Meanwhile, we rejoice. We rejoice. We do not get pulled down into the maelstrom. No, we're rejoicing. It's like a classic movie where there's a poker game or some game, and when they lay the hand down, they say, "Aha!" Aaron goes, "Oh my gosh! You know, you're going to win everything. The villain has won, and the villain's going to take over." And someone else lays down their hand. that's even worse. We're doomed. And then the hero then finally somehow puts their cards down, and oh my gosh, we're saved. We didn't lose after all. It's classic. Classic. And so that's what we have to look forward to now. That's what we have to look forward to, is this wonderful time of Jesus laying his cards on the table, where we get to rejoice, you know, that we're not going to be pulled down into it. We're not going to go the way of arrogance. There's an alternative. See God, be a Christ. See God, be a Christ. See God, be a Christ. That's the option to arrogance. See God and be a Christ. That's dropping our arrogance, is it not? Absolutely it is. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. to assert anything other than that, to see anything other than that, is sheer arrogance. So, see God, be a Christ, is dropping our arrogance, isn't it? How are we doing on this? Oh, we got a few more minutes to go. It is dropping our arrogance. Absolutely it is. See God, be a Christ. See God, be a Christ. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. See God, be a Christ. Rejoice, rejoice. I rejoice, I rejoice, I rejoice. I am already rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing. I am seeing God. I am being a Christ. I am rejoicing. I am seeing God. I am being a Christ. I am already rejoicing. I am seeing God. I am being a Christ. I am already rejoicing. I am seeing God. I am being a Christ. I am already rejoicing. I am seeing God. I am being a Christ. Now, the fatigue that can come from all this, you know, this is tough, but full stop. Don't go into your defenses. Just full stop. Say, hey, I'll just get used to this. I can get used to this. I'm coming out of the shock. I'm feeling like a little bit of rejoicing here, yeah. Check out your dreams. Maybe you'll see Jesus too. Maybe you'll realize that, hey, yes, it's true. It's absolutely true. So again, rejoice, because we realize all our suffering is just our defenses against, you know, supporting arrogance. All our suffering. Once we set those down, goodbye suffering. Hello, peace of mind. There's no more reason to employ wrong advice and total mental chaos. No more reason to whatsoever. So they don't happen. We don't have any need for them to happen whatsoever. So we abide in perfect no advice and total mental stability, total peace, total mental peace. See God be a Christ. 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 I can title the video that. See God be a Christ. Yeah. And remember, there's no one that doesn't have some desire for salvation. Even those who are fomenting so much trouble, they too have a desire for salvation. It's just not yet strong enough for them to not turn to their retreat and turn to defensiveness, to defenses of arrogance. That's okay, but they do have, deep down, they do have. So acknowledge that. Acknowledge in everyone the desire to be saved. Everyone has that. Their attention may be distracted from it very severely, but it's still there. So see God be a Christ. See God be a Christ. See God be a Christ. Almost to the end. More interruption. Plain. See God be a Christ. 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 Wow. I don't know what my hours are going to be like now. It's just, I don't know. It's just full stop in the wow. And just remind, full stop in the wow. I don't have to remember what I said here. I know the shock is going to be strong, so again, I don't fall for the trick of saying, okay, oh, you're so great, you're so wonderful. If only you could remember what you said before, and then that you start thinking, I can't remember, and then you fall prey then to the defenses. So I just say, ah, you know, I know I said it. I know it's right. Don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. I'm just in the wow right now, where I'm a little bit, you know, forgetful of it. That's normal, totally normal. So if you forget what was said here, but you've been into it, and you forget, that's normal, that's fine. Just say, hey, I'm in the full stop in the wow phase of my practicing now. And then you'll pick up the script, flipping the script later on. Oftentimes in the morning, I'll flip the script and get back and remember what I said the previous night and be able to then build upon it. So this is what really produces fast progress for you. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. See God, be a Christ. See God, be a Christ. I'm seeing God and being a Christ. I am 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 seeing God and being a Christ. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow now. Full stop in the wow. Put it in neutral for a while. Put it in neutral. Put it in neutral. Put it in neutral. Put it in neutral. Full stop in the wow. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. I'm seeing God. I'm already seeing God. I'm already being a Christ. I'm seeing God, I'm being a Christ. I'm seeing God, I am being a Christ. I am seeing God, I am being a Christ. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow now. Full stop in the wow. I don't have to remember. I don't have to remember how I got here. I know I've gotten here. That's good enough for now. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow, and then eventually flip the script. Okay, very great.